Hi, everyone.
Hello.
Hi.
Say hi.
This is our first, like, regular family update video that we've ever done. Where it's not...
It's not just about the pregnancy or about the baby.
We're not opening a box or something that. So, we promised in the last video that we would share a story about when you were at the hospital.
My doctor? The story about the doctor?
Yeah. Yeah. So... The doctor was great.
Yeah,
he was real good, and he was efficient. And the C-section, he performed this C-section, and they were really good.
The hospital in general was great. We should probably back up and say that the practice that I went to the same practice all through my pregnancy, but they don't guarantee that you're going to get the same doctor. Mm-hmm. So you really can't pick a doctor because you just don't know who's going to be on call. And even though I scheduled a C-section, they scheduled it with somebody who had never even seen. Mm-hmm. So anyways, I ended up having to have the baby earlier. And so I had never met this doctor before. He had never seen me and none of that. But it just works with the same group. So he just goes off what my record says.
Yep. Yep. So we get there and we're in, what was that, the triage?
It's like triage. It's like triage. It's pre-labor and delivery, yeah.
Yeah. So we're there and it's like, it's a little room.
Mm-hmm.
It's a little room.
I know. And there's curtains. There's other women in there who are in labor. And one who was in like advanced labor, people that are like coming in and they're saying like, no, because you could hear everything through the curtain, whether you want to or not. I could see that. I could hear the person next to me and they were saying like, you're not doing anything. You need to go home.
Yeah. So it's like a room, this like smaller than our living room. And there's like six women in there that are in labor.
Yeah, it was small.
And I'm not going to talk trash about any woman that's in labor and how much pain that they're in. All I'll say is that in that room, there's varying reactions to the pain.
Yes, there was, yes.
So we're in there, and we know she's Breech. She's Frank Breech. We know that already based on, we had a ton of ultrasounds leading up.
So what they do is you tell them, I said, like, listen, she's Breech at my last ultrasound. I don't think she slipped. I think I would know if she turned. And they're like, yeah, you probably know. So we have to do an ultrasound, and then after we do that, we confirm it, then we go to the doctor and we tell the doctor, this is what's going to happen. Here's your doctor's name that's going to perform it if you have to have a C-section. So they came in and they did like a quick ultrasound. Yep, the baby's Breech. We didn't know what she was yet, but the baby's Breech. And then they said, we'll get the ball rolling and it'll be at this time. And then you need to wait and the doctor will come in and speak to you.
Yep. So we're hanging out and it wasn't very long at all.
No.
It wasn't very long at all. And the doctor came in and he comes in and, Melissa's laying in the bed. I'm just kind of hanging out. I'm texting people, telling them what's happening. Melissa's in labor. And the doctor comes in and he's very sincere. And he gets her on the shoulder and he like looks at her and he's like,
he tells me, he's like, I'm so sorry, I can't deliver you like regular. Like he thought for whatever reason he must have thought because maybe I think he thought I didn't know that she was Breech. And so he came in, he's like, I'm so sorry. If you were my patient, I might try to attempt it, even though the baby's Breech.
Yeah.
But I don't know you well enough to know. And blah, 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 blah. I mean, like this big long sob story, how he was so sorry and everything. And I was like, wait a minute. I go, listen, I don't know what you've been told, but I knew she was Breech. And I'm totally okay with having a C-section.
Yeah. And he was like, you see this wave of like relaxation over. He was like, oh, thank God.
Yeah, he said, he goes, oh, thank God.
He thought for sure that, that we were still going to want to have a natural birth.
Yeah, or that I was going to be upset about it or something like that.
That you weren't going to be able to and that you were going to be upset. So he, for like a couple minutes, washed over him like, oh, thank God this woman knows that it's okay to have a C-section. And she already knows head time. So then he goes into this rant. He's like, some women come in here and they want to do everything their way and they bring in other people and it's like all about my vagina.
Yeah, about having the baby come out my vagina. And he's like really loud and he's like, my vagina, my vagina, my vagina. That's all they care about. And I'm like, oh my God. And everyone else can hear. I know they can hear it through the curtain. So, I mean, he was really funny. But he's like, oh, I'm glad you know. And I mean, he was really sincere. And he said, I'm glad you know and I'm glad you know. He didn't try and push me, like, say, well, why did you turn the baby or any of those things? He was just like, okay, great.
And he's like, cool, we'll come get you.
And then I guess I should say that when we did get into there, to actually have the baby, after they took her out and everything, he came over to me and told me that he's like, it's good you didn't try to have her turned because she was jammed up into your rib cage, and the cord was wrapped around her neck.
Yeah.
So he's like, must have been like your intuition or something that you knew. Like, and when
she was born, she had like a flat, her head was flat.
Because she was pushed right up into my rib cage.
Yeah.
So he's like, she wouldn't have turned. There's no way she would have turned. And it could have been dangerous because the cord being wrapped around her neck would have been.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah.
So we got a vagina rant from our doctor.
I thought it was funny. Actually, I was disappointed that I hadn't met him sooner. And I was like, dang, I could have had him as my doctor this whole time.
Yeah.
Like, he's great. He was super nice and friendly. And so everyone was. Like, the anesthesiologist was great. Everyone was great.
Oh, yeah. You're going to join in? So that's one of our hospital stories. And birth stories.
Yeah.
So what was going on this week?
Well, Francesca had a big week. She's going to be 4 months old on Wednesday. So this Wednesday come on the 6th. So she, on Friday, she laughed and she rolled over on Saturday.
Which I missed both.
No, you saw the rolling over. You're here on
Saturday. Oh, that's true. That's true. That. But she had rolled over sooner.
Yeah, she had like partially rolled, like half rolled. But she rolled all the way over. From her stomach to her back, and then she's done it from her back to her stomach too. But she laughed like real laugh, like a belly laugh.
Mm-hmm.
And then, yeah, so she had a big week. She's done two milestone things, so she's right on track for what she's supposed to do. And she's clearly teething. So she's got everything in her mouth. I went and bought her a teether thing for the freezer.
Everything's jammed in her mouth. Everything right in her mouth. She loves to chew on her hands. She gets her hands together like this, and she's like.
Yep. Yeah, so she hasn't been too fussy, but it's been definitely like, you know, drooling and like runny nose kind of situation, and
just—it's like stereotype teething.
Yeah, and my other kids didn't do those things, so it's like,
whoever those kids are,
you know, they know who our kids are.
But yeah, you know, she does all the stereotype stuff when it comes to the teething. She's drooling, and I'm anti bib, no bib.
I'm not, but I don't keep a bib on her because he makes fun of me for doing it. So.
Well, I also take him off as soon as you put him on.
I know. Yeah. So she's like drooling, and then she's like doesn't have very much of an appetite because her mouth is bothering her.
Mm-hmm.
So I got her the ice, like a heart shape teether. You put it in the freezer, and she loved it.
Yeah.
So hopefully that'll help give her some relief.
She loves it. And then you took a trip to Once Upon a Child. Yeah,
she needed a new onesies because she's outgrown everything.
Because she's gigantor.
No. And all she basically wears is onesies and like little stretch pants.
Yeah,
so.
You know, it's already getting hot too.
Yeah, it's already warm here, so she can be just perfectly content in a onesie.
I was just looking at the weather, and it's going to be like 90 tomorrow and like 95 on Monday.
Why?
We live on the surface of the sun.
Yeah, we do. It's been nice this week, though. It was nice, and it was cold. People were wearing sweaters on Wednesday because it was 68 or something.
It was 68 degrees.
Oh, my gosh.
Sweaters and turning the heater on.
Yep.
So you went to Once Upon a Child.
Yep, and
that place. So, from my perspective, as like someone who like I don't go cold shopping, I don't buy the kids stuff, stuff like that. That place is chaos.
It was chaos. It was a lot of there's a lot of people trying to sell things because they buy your stuff. So there's a lot of people trying to sell things, and there's a lot of kids just like running around with little carts pushing the carts.
Yeah, that's what it was. It's like if you were to take Black Friday shopping and make everyone miniature.
Yeah, exactly. The kids have these, like, they have like these little miniature carts, and the kid kept trying to, this little boy kept trying to run it into her in the car seat. But anyways, so she needed new onesies, and they have, like, a promotion that if you buy, it's like, they're just $1, it's 10 for 10. So so I went and got her some new onesies. I got her some, just show a couple.
Yeah. That's a good shelf.
It's a natural shelf. What other ones? Let's see.
Yeah.
Just a couple.
So, Melissa's a fan of the ones with the ruffles on the butt.
Yes, I am.
Everything's got to have something on, like a print or like ruffles them. Or a patch or fancy. Something like that on the butt.
She could be fancy. I mean, this is all she wears, basically. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, I never check her. I'm weird, though. I don't take her out of the house without pants on. That's weird to me. So, she wears pants when we leave the house.
Well, I mean, you do change her. Like, she has pajamas. Like, she, you get her up, and then you change her into regular clothes.
She doesn't need to wear pajamas all day.
And then you put her in pajamas when she goes to bed.
She has pajamas. I do. I'm weird like that. I don't like the whole, I don't like seeing kids run around in diapers either, so,
So, she's starting to be on a schedule now.
Yes, I started her on a schedule, like, a strict one, and it's pretty much evolved into now she has her own schedule, and she set it for herself, and she goes to bed at the same time. She still wakes up in the middle of the night just just once, but at the almost the exact same time. And then she eats like on the regular schedule. So yeah, she's.
Yeah, yeah. Except, and then that's the times where she decides to puke all over the wall.
Because of the teething, because she's got like a lot of saliva, I guess. I mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, she's definitely the. She's a spit up baby. Yeah.
So that's all that was going on this week with the baby. She's progressing along nice and good. Everything's on schedule. Actually, she's a little bit ahead on some stuff.
Yes.
Because she does the, she sees stuff and reaches for it.
Like from far away. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. And she can see, she can follow you with her eyes too from far away.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So yeah. She tries to grab her toys.
She's already, she's already done. She has a doctor's appointment on Wednesday the 6th, and she'll go get her 4-month checkup, and then she gets shots and stuff. So
and she does like she rolled over, right? Mm-hmm. And then she hasn't done it since.
Yeah, she did like 5 or 6 times last week when she did it, and then now she's like, okay, I'm good.
Because she's totally on to like what could happen. All she has to do is go, and then someone else will turn her over.
Me. She doesn't like it. She's upset. We have to turn her over.
2, 3, 4 So down there, over there. There he is, sitting in the hallway.
He's a creeper.
That's Karate Man. Look, I'll move over away. Move out of the way there.
That's so. Yep. He had a karate belt graduation today, which will be Saturday. So he is now officially a purple belt. So
kicking ass.
Yeah. He was an orange belt. Now he's a purple belt, and his next would be a blue belt, which is like about what, 3 belts away from being. I don't know. I think it's like 3 or 4 from black.
I don't know. Only way I measure karate is. If it's like, it's 3 layers. It's your beginner, then you go to Bloodsport. What's that?
The Kumite.
Kumite. So it goes beginner, Kumite, and then Seattle Karate.
I'm sorry, but Seattle Karate is not better than the Kumite. But
I had a run-in with that guy. Did this. This. That. What'd you fight about? He was talking about how bad Seattle Karate is. Yeah.
What?
Yeah, he was putting Seattle Karate down in a big way and talking about how wonderful Los Angeles Karate is.
Yeah, Seattle Karate is at the top. You know why? Because they don't like it when you come there and you talk garbage about Seattle Karate. They're going to lay the hammer down on you.
No one's going to get that except for like very few people. But yeah, he did good. He did really good. They have to do, like a warm up and they have to do what's called the kata, which is an element. And it's like all this very strict stuff. And so he had
to learn
that. It's
weird when we first went there, like when we were looking around for something.
You didn't know anything about karate, we should say, in advance.
And it was like we're looking around for something that he could do and it would be, you know, have exercise, but then also be teamwork and stuff like that. And it was weird. Like we went there, and the first things they talked about were like all the exact things that
we
talked
wanted
to
them to. Yeah, talk. Yeah. Confidence, like, and self-esteem were huge things for us that we wanted that to be instilled.
Yeah.
And and respect, and they are like, it was like something like they had read our minds, and we're like, we're just gonna cater. They're really great. I have to say, like, whatever. They are like, they're only my own experience with karate, but they are wonderful. Like, it's a whole family that does it. And all the teachers are great, and I can't say enough good things about them.
Yeah.
And they really know Demetrius.
Oh no, really?
She's gonna start to get hungry.
So, and then right across the parking lot from
the karate
is this new place. It's like a soda fountain.
Yeah, it's called
an ice cream.
It's called Soda Rush. It's like this little soda shop. It's actually like a family owned place. It's great. You know, they make they have their own signature drinks that they make up where they add, like, for example, I had one that had cherries and cherry Coke and then like cream and Dr. Pepper in it and all this stuff. Anyways, so they have, dairy-free ice cream and floats and stuff like that. And that's where all the teen kids hang out.
Yeah. Yeah. And so we're parents of a
teen.
And, I'm not supposed to go into detail and talk about it, but we'll just say that maybe we know a teen that met another teen at a stereotypical date place.
Yes, maybe twice.
Like a soda place.
Maybe they've done this twice, maybe. Yeah, so. That's happened.
And then this is the day I realize how much of an old man I am. That I'm the father of a teenager.
I don't know what you're talking about. I'm young, so you might be old, but.
So, no, I mean, it's world done change.
You mean going to the Fall Out Boy concert was not enough?
Oh, yeah, that's right. That happened, too.
That happened between. Yeah. That was like.
Yeah, so last Friday, we went to, me and Isabel went and saw AWOL Nation, Pivris, and Fall Out Boy. And actually, the show was pretty good.
Her first concert, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, the show was pretty good. I would actually go see it again. You know, it wasn't like they're, you know, on par with some of the other my favorite shows that I've been to.
Well, your favorite shows are not appropriate to take Isabel to. So
she can totally go to Lamb of God Slayer.
No, I'm sorry.
Totally.
No. Nope.
So it was pretty good. Like it was, they had a lot of like extra stuff, like save, yes, yeah, stage stuff where they like made the snow and there's fire and then they let off some fireworks and there was a lot going on the stage. It was pretty busy. And man, it was like, if you, like, I talk about feeling like an old man now. That was literally like, the only people that were there were somewhere between the ages of 12 and 20.
Yeah, and their parents, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And then some old people hanging out, like me, hanging out with their kids. The funny part was, is there like some point in time where we, as adults, like, we just stop having fun?
Yeah.
Remember when you're young and, like, you go see a concert that you've never seen before? Like, you don't know who the band is. And you go, and you still have a good time, right? Yeah, you dance along to the music, and you watch the show, and you just have a good time, right? You don't know the band. You just have a good time, right?
Yeah, that's half the thing. You go when you go to the shows that you know the people first. Like the openers, you don't know them, but you still enjoy the music, yeah.
Yeah. So at what age do we just, like, give up? Like, do we just stop?
Not gonna have fun.
Yeah, we just stop having fun and, like, and throw that stuff out. Because I'm looking around while the show is on, and in every direction, wherever there's a parent, there's just, like, everyone else is standing up, and they're watching the show, and these parents are sitting down, and they're looking at their phone, checking their work email, looking at ESPN, you know? Yeah. It's like, the music is so loud, and people are jumping around and dancing.
And there's you sitting there.
Yeah, and there's you. Yeah, there's you responding to work emails.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, time and place, people. Come on. Yeah. I mean, it must be the same age. It must absolutely be the same age where old people stop standing up for a concert. They just sit down and clap to the beat.
Not good, though. Not well, no. And they fight for samples at Costco.
Yeah,
that's the same
true.
Age.
That's true. I mean, you know, watch out if there's ever like a free sample of a hot dog at a Costco.
Corn dogs.
Oh, especially. Hell's going to break loose. Start busting kneecaps. Breaking people's necks. Yep. Everyone turns into Chuck Norris with a shopping cart.
Yeah, exactly.
There's free corn dogs.
Yep, exactly. We know this from experience. That's why we say that.
So, all right. Well, that pretty much sums up what was going on this week with us.
Francesca wants the microphone. That's
you
what
want talking to the microphone?
Want to say something?
So, that's pretty much it from us this week.
Yep.
And we're going to keep going. Let us know if you like the new format and if there's any new stuff you want to talk about, a little shorter, a little longer, you know, maybe some different, like some video from during the week or something like that, we can add that in.
Yep.
So that's it for now. Say bye, Frankie.
Say bye, Francesca.
Bye.